Hello, everyone. Greetings. We're so excited that you joined us for the Pan-African Film Series with the All African People's Revolutionary Party Southwest Chapter. It happens every second Saturday of the month. I am Monica, and I am a member of the AAPRP, and we have us with us as well, Afro Phoenix. Afro Phoenix, you want to say hi?
Hi, everybody. I've missed you all, but it's great to be back.
Wonderful. Our AAPRP was started in 1968 by Kwame Nkrumah, calling for a one unified socialist Africa. And there are AAPRP chapters all over the world, as well as all over the United States as well, working to have a one unified socialist Africa, organizing for our land back, organizing for our liberation and our freedom. And so we're excited that you've joined us for the film series today. We're going to be showing The Future Coming Toward Us. It's a documentary about Maurice Bishop and the New Jewel Movement that helped organize Grenada, before US imperialism destroyed it. So we're excited. What we'll do is for the first 53 minutes or so, watch the film together. And then after that, we'll have a discussion about the film. You can post your thoughts and comments and questions in the chat. And so we're so excited again for you to join us. And here we go, we're gonna start the film.
Oh. On June 5th, 1983, Grenada's Prime Minister, Maurice Bishop, addressed an audience of some 3,000 people at Hunter College in New York City. Bishop was in the United States as part of his government's long-standing policy to normalize relations with the United States. But the Reagan administration, rather than consenting to meet with the Prime Minister, stepped up its attacks against Grenada, accusing the Bishop government of being a Soviet Cuban pawn and a threat to democracy in the region.
The real reason for all of this hostility is because some perceive that what is happening in Grenada can lay the basis for a new socio-economic and political path of development. They give all kinds of reasons and excuses, some of them credible, some utter rubbish. There's an interesting one that we saw very recently in a secret report of the State Department. I want to tell you about that one, so you can reflect on that one. That secret report made this point, that Grenada is different to Cuba and Nicaragua, and the Grenada Revolution is in one sense even worse, I'm using their language, than the Cuban and Nicaraguan revolutions, because the people of Grenada and the leadership of Grenada speaks English and therefore can communicate directly to the people of the United States. But I want to tell you what that same report also said, and said that also made us very dangerous. And that is that the people of Grenada and the leadership of Grenada are predominantly black. They said that 95% of our population is black, and they had a correct statistic. And if we have 95% of predominantly African origin in our country, then we can have a dangerous appeal to 30 million black people in the United States.
Less than 5 months after his appearance at Hunter College, Maurice Bishop, a number of leading members of the New Jewel movement, and many Grenadan citizens were killed. Six days later, following the executions and killings, 6,000 U.S. troops, supported by helicopter gunships, fighter aircraft, and a large naval task force from the world's most powerful nation, invaded Grenada, the smallest sovereign nation in the Western Hemisphere.
To take them out of this old style, where they just come from their field and from the field to their bed. After a while, people begin to understand that all lives don't have to be so hard. Things can change, you know.
Going out of days when our mothers and sisters were sex exploited for jobs.
Today, the people are enjoying many more democratic rights and freedoms, and are much more involved and participating in the building of our revolutionary process.
Our country has different things we want to form. Normalize the people, teach, learn for myself, the youth, the old, the young, in education. All such of things that will be in help to build the revolution.
Caribbean is a region of many cultures and peoples who share a common history. Grenada, Carriacou, and Petite Martinique make up a small country in the Caribbean Sea. The country's 110,000 people are mostly of African descent. They took control of their lives and their future through a revolution on March 13, 1979, the first revolution in the English-speaking Caribbean.
If we are going to talk about the revolution in Grenada, first of all, there was no freedom. There was definitely a government that was in power to keep down each and every person in this island that had the ability or the ambition to
go forward,
lift the head of the water. We know that for a fact.
So we're in a different era than all that means. We need a big revolution
in a little country.
In a little country.
Yes.
With the esteem of Grenada doing. And the progress he's making.
We know the future, we could see the future coming towards us, right?
March 13, 1979, comrades, was a bright new dawn for the people of Grenada and the working people of the Caribbean. That dawn marked the end of the long, dark night of terror and the beginning of a new day for our people.
As Prime Minister Maurice Bishop said, this revolution is creating a new democracy. It has opened up great opportunities for the people to participate in making the decisions which affect their everyday lives and the future of their country. It has brought them hope. It has brought them joy.
I once thought that a man has a right to law, maybe a woman or something of the sort. But I later learned that a man has a right to love his country first. We slave for a colonial system, a capitalistic, an imperialistic system. But no, we're slaving for ourselves. If you call it slavery, we're slaving for ourselves. It didn't come by an accident. It came through the struggling people of this country. with the will to freedom, sis.
First, the Arawaks inhabited the island, and then the Caribs, from whom the region gets its name. When the Europeans came to the region, many Caribs resisted and were killed. Some leaped to death in the sea rather than submit to domination. From the time Europeans first came to this region, they fought one another for control of the area's land, wealth, and sea lanes. Some of the territories fell under British control, others under Spanish, French, or Dutch, but all suffer from the effects of 400 years of exploitation. The British eventually gained control of Grenada and incorporated the island into their colonial system of triangular trade. This system took raw materials and luxury items to Europe and brought finished manufactured goods from Europe to the colonies.
I want to get a job.
Africans were captured and brought to the colonies to provide the needed labor. Following the abolition of slavery in 1833, the former slaves were free to work as wage earners on the large estates owned by a local elite. But the triangular trading pattern still continues.
Anything of ours that had any value, had any worth, anything that we were able to produce that can get some money for, have been shipped away. In a way, it seems as if our whole life or people or culture or being have been made to be shipped away to the metropolitan countries. In that whole process of shipping ourselves away, we have been underdeveloped. We have been consciously underdeveloped, if you can call it that way.
Among agricultural workers, you know, they have to get up early in the morning, go to work, come back, hurry home in the afternoon. And this thing had to go on every day. They lived in houses that were falling down. They couldn't buy adequate food at the end of the week because they were only working from $12 and $15 at the end of the week. And what did they get for it?
When the industrialized countries suffered under the Great Depression of the 1930s, many Grenadians were forced to go to other islands seeking work. There they soon became involved in the trade union and anti-colonial movements which had sprung up throughout the region. In the early 1950s, one Eric Matthew Gary returned to Grenada and organized a union for agricultural workers.
He used this position to gain political power, and when Grenada became independent in 1974, Gary became its first prime minister. Sir Eric Gary permitted the economy of his country to continue to serve foreign interests, and he aligned Grenada with other repressive regimes. At the height of Gary's repression, he sent members of his security force to Augusto Pinochet's Chile for training in torture techniques. By now, the United States was the dominant force in the region, and it projected Gary as a respectable Caribbean leader. But he led his people to believe that the key to his success and power came from God.
So Eric Gary projects himself as the only person that stands between God and Grenadians. He said several times that he was only answerable to God.
He made the statement himself.
And so people did not find it very easy to challenge the leader. Since the leader was God's representative on earth, he was ruling by divine right.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
And therefore all questions relating to his his tenure of office relating to his abuses and so forth should not be directed to him, but indeed should be directed to God.
In the midst of Gary's tyranny, he was knighted by the Queen of England.
We did not have to read a Karl Marx to understand what, in fact, was before our eyes for all our lives.
Gary's personal corruption led the country into economic decline. Agricultural production dropped 25%. Unemployment rose to 47%. Food prices rose 200%. Clothing 164%. Housing 135%. Moreover, he sexually exploited women who sought work in the public sector. Gary built no new roads, no new schools, no new infrastructure.
Under Gary, there were roads in the hole rather than holes in the road. So bad was the situation. You know, to take a bus from Grenville to St. George's used to cost a laborer what that laborer would make in a day. Remember people coming down the road, either cursing or crying or, you know, in dismay from the kinds of lack of social services that there were in the country. People were taking out their teeth instead of having it repaired because to fill a tooth was so expensive. I remember the situation facing people for medical care, where people would go and sit for hours and hours and hours.
These conditions led to widespread anger and dissatisfaction among Grenadians. The New Jewel movement became the leading opposition party, presenting the people with a platform which clearly outlined a new social and economic system. This approach allowed the people to organize their anger against the Gary regime and his secret police force, the Mongoose Gang.
You look at the Mongoose Gang, and their job, as given by Gary, was to harass, intimidate, beat up, and murder anybody who was opposed to Eric Gary.
They even assassinated Rupert Bishop, the father of the present prime minister.
Gary moved in with more and more army forces, and then the guns started firing. I was backed by four gunmen. But I passed through because I can't walk faster than a gunshot. There's no use of running.
The unrest continued to mount in the country. In 1979, Gary planned to have the entire NJM leadership killed while he was on a trip to the United States.
The plan was that Gary was going to leave the country on Monday midday. And the instructions that were being left behind was that we should be liquidated. That left us in a position where we had to choose whether to sit and wait for liquidation or whether we should move on the offensive. What we did was that from our positions in hiding, the decision was taken that the next morning we should, at this point, in the name of the people, move to seize power from the hands of the dictatorship.
It took approximately 24 hours for the revolutionary forces, people who responded to the call of the revolution, to in fact seize political power in our country.
The government of the criminal dictator Eric M. Gary has been overthrown.
Only two people were killed during the revolt. The Mongoose Gang was detained in prison. None were executed. Not even the men who killed Rupert Bishop were harmed.
All religious rights and freedom are now restored.
When describing the day of the revolution, a 72-year-old woman said, "When we hear news of the revolution, it was joy come out. I lifted above the sky."
Gary is a wanted man.
But this new freedom also meant facing the reality of a country in complete economic disarray. Nearly half of the workforce was unemployed. There was only $24 left in the national treasury. The new government and the people had to move swiftly to bring benefits to the people and at the same time institute a plan for long-term economic stability.
Well, the revolution means a lot to me. It means a lot because it helped me so much that I can't really, tell how great the things, it means a lot.
Everybody putting their hands and heart together.
And I feel we're making a lot of progress because they're seeing the country go forward. You can see the action of the people with smiles and things.
3 years after the revolution, the World Bank reported a growth in Grenada's economy of 2% at a time when most of the other countries of the world were in an economic decline. Despite the ongoing hardships, people can see that things are getting better. Over 12,000 people have benefited from the housing repair program. Low-income housing is available for the first time. Healthcare is recognized as a right for all people.
We've had an increase in the number of doctors that are working in the general hospital, the subsidiary hospitals in Carrick-Upity-Martinique. We have not only had an increase in quantity, but we've had an increase in quality. We've had assistance from a lot of the friendship groups, from a lot of countries, from organizations that comprise not only Grenadians, but other internationalists in solidarity with the revolution in Grenada.
It really interests me how revolutionary politics influences health and health medicine, and especially also how they are going to build up this sort of primary health care system here. That's what interested me most.
To maintain their power, the colonialists kept the people uneducated, thus preventing the development of the country. Now, for the first time in a century, a new public secondary school has been built. The National Women's Organization provides free school books and uniforms for the children of very low-income families. And sports, cultural, and recreational programs are provided after school for children 5 through 14.
I really like pioneers, and I do a lot of skits and so. And in the pioneers, we encourage all to be good at school, to learn the lessons and so. And later days to come, we could be the prime minister or the minister or so.
From the southeast and central zone, we have Negro Church.
We want the kids in the United States of America to be free as we in Grenada, in revolutionary Grenada. We are the flowers of the revolution, the pioneers.
Look at it again.
When we have free education, don't have to pay for that. Some times ago, I know I had to pay $50 a term for my son to go to school and my daughter. But now, here it is, free education.
Our people have made the revolution. The revolution is the people. And without educating and preparing them for the role that they have to play within the change that is taking place now, we would not have a revolution.
Yeah. I am from Grenada, Carrick, and Piti, Martinique.
You
are from Martinique. He is from Aruba.
The Center for Popular Education immediately tackled the problem of adult illiteracy, lowering it to 5% in less than 3 years.
From the Caribbean.
Your trainer don't ask you at any point in time, daddy, assist me. Is your mother to do this song, that song?
That is what I'm talking about, really.
Right, and you get a problem because you haven't got the reason and writing skill to show them what to do.
What hurt me heart is when you see they go to school and they come back and they have their homework to do and they having some tough time. I don't know what to tell them. Like, I'm really, really interested. They really feel me there.
Right.
Because, I mean, who to tell them? It's we.
Right.
We are one people. We are one Caribbean.
I think most people appreciate that all education is development. Even during the construction of the airport, we benefiting not just the money that's being spent to construct the airport, but the skills that have been acquired at present by Grenadian working on the airport. And when we get a highly skilled group of Grenadians who had been trained at present at the airport. This will lead to further economic development of the country when the airport is completed, because they can go into other construction.
Capital investment has increased by over 700% since the days of Eric Gehry.
I worked with government for about 15 years, and I operate this tractor, and I find everything going well with this project. But under when I used to work in the past government, I used to be laid off certain time because, you know, it didn't have much work. But I find now you have plenty of work, and I like to work at Eastern Main Road because I want to see the project success. So I train all my best to help.
Since after the revolution, I feel the country progressed a lot, right? Because the construction that going through.
We want to build an economy. We want to build an economy, you know, and at least, well, you know, we know you're imperialist strong, but somehow you want to build yourself.
What's up with this side to Burundi
Hula Group? We have to understand that after 400 years of backwardness and dependency, it is sometimes difficult to get people to do things for themselves that is difficult to do. In NWO, we have a major role to organize women, to educate them, to understand that as women, they have to struggle to bring more benefits to themselves.
Have transport for young, old, and everybody.
And it is a difficult task, you know, for NWO organizers.
You NWOM badge, handle it with care.
Yes, we have to sit down and have a lot of talking with the people, because some hard, some.
I'm very happy.
Gradually, we start unfolding and telling all different gains. I say, well, even when you join the group, you're not going to come to meeting every meeting night or every meeting day or every rally you're going to go or so. But it's a struggle for women, and you're a woman.
The National Women's Organization has secured laws guaranteeing such rights as equal pay for equal work and paid maternity leave. Still, women are often uncertain of their new role in the society.
And some of them say, oh, I'm not going to join this thing will collapse and all kind of a thing.
Up to last night, we had the meeting and one was right by me. And they enjoyed itself well. And that is what we want.
Not a brother, but a sister working at the That's a tremendous step forward for women. The movement of our women is part of the movement of all our people to extend the rights and the power of all our people in our society.
It doesn't matter if it's women's rally or not, if it's men's rally. It's just the same thing, the same struggle.
There's a workers' class where they educate the workers, the young, the old. Before that, under the Gehry government, we know nothing about workers' class. But right now, under this present government, we have a workers' class and educating the workers. Some of them who leave school when they were small, right now they're getting education about the years gone by, history.
I'll put another way, the different class forces involved. Right? In this struggle. You understand what I mean?
The workers have come from a background of myth, fallacy, and they have been brambled and misused in the past.
the working class must begin to look and see what role it's playing, how things are affecting it. This is something we saw before as we studied, right?
Most of them have left school and probably from that time never related to anything in any manner like that. In the beginning, we did have a lot of problem in getting convincing some workers that they should participate in the class. And some of them were a little bit skeptical and, you know, they didn't have too much confidence, right? But as they got the substance of what the class is all about, the participation increased.
What happened for later? We can take 2 drinks for later.
How could they get it right now?
From the time you put the banana into the ground, you have to know the end result. You actually have to end up knowing who is going to eat that banana. The whole process, which boat takes it, you know, how much it costs, and who pays for it. And to learn all the intricacies. And this is something that has been very much neglected. Now, if the workers do not understand that, how then could they really apply themselves in a meaningful way to ensure that what they are doing is successful?
When they come and get your food, man.
Cunha is an agricultural worker who invented a trap using local wood to catch cocoa beetles, which were destroying this valuable crop.
Well, you see, I understand by own self. That is the very method for it, the trap. So by that, we put it set like that.
Once the beetles have been attracted away from the cocoa trees and onto the traps, workers collect the small piles of wood and kill the insects.
When you consider that 2 years ago on a farm like this, you have had literally hundreds of these beetles. And today when you walk around, you literally have to search well in order to see a beetle.
The only thing I could find now is one dead one I had very long in a bottle. Cannot find none of the estate again in a hurry. So if you kill all the beetle from the area, no damage, more cocoa.
Agricultural workers have the potential, and once they're given the proper environment, once they're given their freedom to think, and there's a sense where they see they have a role, and there is something which gives them an independence and a status, people will come forward with fantastic ideas.
Prices for Grenada's main export crops, nutmeg, cocoa, and bananas, are controlled by the world market, so the country can never predict its own income potential. Grenada, with some assistance from international development agencies, is now diversifying crops and utilizing modern farming techniques to get out of this state of dependence.
What we see happening now is the production of our goods put to the benefit of our people. The whole question of agro-industrial development, the whole question of our people looking into our culture, our identity, studying our history to see how we can change this process, how we can start holding what belongs to us within our country for our own development. And we see development living, coming into being within our country.
Minister of Finance Bernard Cord explained the significance of the new agro-industrial plan at the first international conference in solidarity with Free Grenada.
With 400 years of private sector in Grenada and 400 years of 8 million pounds of mangoes falling on the ground and rotting on trees throughout Grenada, it took the PRG to take those mangoes and to can and bottle them, put mango slices, mango juice, mango nectar, nutmeg jelly, tamarind juice, tamarind nectar, and all the other ranges of fruits and juices. All of them, first of all, researched, developed, perfected, and now mass-produced by the People's Revolutionary Government after 400 years of private sector.
The fishing industry is another example of how British colonialism kept Grenada from developing its potential. Since the revolution, the PRG has acquired a modern fishing fleet, and men and women are being trained in fishing techniques at the new fishing school. Grenada, a country surrounded by water, found itself actually importing most of its fish and unable to feed its people properly otherwise.
What we produce here must belong to us.
What's ours is ours. We do want what America has, or Canada has, or any other country. We want what we have to be ours.
I am responsible for coordinating food and nutrition programs throughout Grenada, Carico, and Petit Martinique. What we have done since we started is to initiate a system of nutrition assistance to each parish. Our nutrition assistants have been able to make direct contact and face-to-face contact with people in the community so that they're able to discuss what their nutritional problems are, particularly with their young children.
A campaign to eat local has been necessary because colonialism encouraged the people for generations to think that expensive imported food was better. Local foods were symbolic of poverty.
It's only when we recognize the root causes of this kind of problem, and the root causes in our situation lies in the effects of imperialism and the way they want to keep us down, the way the countries who have the money, the way the countries who produce the grain, for example, which is what our people depend on. 70% of our energy intake comes from flour, you know, and that is controlled by the United States, the export of it, the price of it, and all that, right? And people are encouraged to eat this rather than to eat what they produce. People are encouraged to continue at a low productivity level so that they continue to be the consumers of wheat.
The Caribbean is seen fundamentally, or Latin America is seen fundamentally, as a collection of banana republics. Our people are not respected. Our sovereignty is dismissed. In fact, some people see us as Neanderthals.
Such arrogance has always characterized the U.S. involvement in the Caribbean.
The more than 200 interventions made by the United States, military interventions, since the 1790s, more than 100 of those interventions have been in the Caribbean.
These actions have been taken under the guise of fighting the spread of communism and defending the region for U.S.-style democracy. And then, there was June 19th, 1980.
June 19th, 1980 was another occasion for counter-revolutionary destabilization. A bomb was placed where thousands of Grenadian patriots had gathered. This bomb was placed and intended to eliminate and to, you know, make a mass murder of the Grenadian leadership. It did not do that, but three women were murdered. Over 100 people were hospitalized, and the investigations of the government proved that those inside Grenada who were involved in placing the bomb and in making sure that it went off, that they were supported by CIA contact men. And this was yet another occasion when we knew that the CIA was involved in the general destabilization of the country.
On the small island of Grenada, at the southern end of the Caribbean chain, the Cubans, with Soviet financing and backing, are in the process of building an airfield with a 10,000-foot runway. Grenada doesn't even have an air force. Who is it intended for? The Soviet-Cuban militarization of Grenada, in short, can only be seen as power projection into the region, and it is
I have talked with appropriate Navy personnel as well as Air Force personnel who stated unequivocally to me in direct response to questions that I raised, and their statement was that there is no military significance to this airport on the island of Grenada whatsoever. The problems in that region of the world are economic, political, and social and economic. They have to be solved in that context. These are not military problems.
Runway 26.
The present airport is too small for cargo planes and for jets, making it inadequate for meeting the needs of Grenada's agricultural and tourism sectors.
Right now, a lot of people are complaining it's trouble to get to Grenada. And when we have our airport, we won't have that problem anymore. People will be able to leave the States, Canada, wherever they're from, and fly direct here. It'll be much easier for them.
Tourism is second to agriculture as Grenada's source of foreign exchange. The State Department actually contacted travel agents and told them that the government would not be responsible for the safety of U.S. citizens who visit Grenada. The new airport will have a 9,800-foot runway, which is a minimum standard length set by international aviation authorities for the landing of jets. Private firms from the United States, Britain, and Finland have performed major parts of the construction work, but by far the greatest assistance in both funding and construction has come from Cuba.
It would not have been possible without the help and assistance of the Cuban. Long live Cuba Grenada friendship. Long live
Cuba. Despite Grenada's progress, the United States continues to spread misinformation not only about the new airport, but also about human rights within the country.
We have to struggle as people who are being destabilized every day to get people out there to understand the really devastating effects of propaganda.
According to the Bureau, it had received complaints about mass torture being practiced by the Bishop government.
You get this whole question of the disinformation being hidden behind the facade of a free press and a free media generally.
The major media, both inside the U.S. and in the Caribbean region, have persistently published stories which reflect the U.S. government's position about Grenada.
It says there are over 700 political prisoners on the island. The number of prisoners far exceeds the capacity of the jails. So Bishop has ordered the construction of prison farms similar to those existing in Cuba. We have some prison farms now. They are warehousing prisoners in semi-trailers received from Cuba, in which they hold them for many hours under the intense heat of the sun that practically cooks them. We cook in prisoners now in warehouses. This is the same year when if you drive around Grenada, you see the most amount of signs of activity of building. When more and more nationals from abroad are coming back home and building new houses, when more and more activity is going on in all of the other areas in terms of the programs of the revolution.
Despite all the lies and propaganda, the Grenadian people know the truth and are prepared to defend their revolution.
When Gary was in power, and now I'm free, thank God.
Well, we all was under pressure.
We all under pressure.
Well, I used to hide myself.
I joined the militia because I'm trying to protect my grandchildren.
Of course.
Right? And through I in it, many others join because I'm in age. And if I in age and I could join, the others take step.
Me, as a militia woman, I feel as I am equal to any man inside here in defense, but when I come for cooking or whatnot, I will take up my pot and cook. But when I come for defending my country, I will defend my country. Besides a man.
Me and Grenada here, truly, be in solidarity with the people of El Salvador.
Our revolution was the first revolution in the history of the English-speaking Caribbean. Our revolution came out at a time when the people of the world were up in arms about the oppression, when the people of the world were overthrowing dictators.
Let us remember our struggling sisters and brothers in Africa, in Namibia, in South Africa, who are presently fighting against white racist minority regime.
So we have a very historic task, a very noted and remarkable task to ensure that the revolution in Grenada stays there, remains, and that it goes from strength to strength.
If we can't defend our revolution, defend what we fought and struggled so hard to build, we cannot continue to work with the right kind of solutions. If we allow imperialism to turn back this revolution, then we might as well stop working in nutrition, because we will not be able to do the kinds of things that we are doing, because the kinds of things we are doing are related to solving the problems of poverty.
Ordinary step! Man!
So otherwise we're just touching the surface and we're not really answering any questions. We are working without answering any questions.
The United States has stated that Grenada is not democratic because we do not have elections. Our history of electoral rule under the Gary dictatorship did not give our people a chance to have a say in the day-to-day running of Grenada.
Previously, we had elections once every 5 years. Now with the new democracy, the new grassroots democracy, where the masses comes in the organizations and meet on a weekly or monthly basis and discuss a problem in various parts of the country through the mass organization, as different where only 15 men used to discuss the problems of the people before.
Comrades are in favor of the rules as they are presented, and comrades vote using the credential cards, right? Comrades are against. Any against, they show by raise of hand using the credential
cards. The new democracy, the grassroots democracy, everybody will discuss the problems of the country in through the mass organizations, in the various groups in the villages, and then on the parish level and nationally.
Any force that is really held in, whenever it's let loose, like the youth had the opportunity to be let loose on March 13th, then you would find it resulting in things like this. A mass organization of youth, yeah? The youths were suppressed for so long that, well, obviously, once they got the freedom, you know, they felt free to organize themselves, to take part in all the things that they know for their betterment, in the creation of that better, that new and just society that we speak.
I'm very glad.
Our people have rejected the five-year Westminster-style democracy because we don't have to wait 5 years to say what we want as a people. We get it every day. We get the opportunity every day.
And next thing again, the Zonal Council meeting. We never had that under Gary dictatorship, right? But now that we have it under this government, you could go in, tell them, well, what you feel you want for your villages, and different places, right? What you feel they should do. And they take a good at least, listen to what you're saying. But under the Gary dictatorship, we never had that. Gary see and he's all, when he say this, that go on, right? So I feel we're going forward. I feel we're moving.
You're hoping that I will tell you that by tomorrow morning, all the roads
in St. George's, or in the parish of St. George's, will be in excellent order.
Of course, a workers' council is something which is entirely new to me.
No doubt you were thinking that someone who were answering questions in such a big gathering for the first time might have been a bit shy. But no, the workers' council, one is able to do exactly what the workers' council is intended, to go there without being ashamed and ask and answer questions in the best possible and honest way in which one can do so.
Why it is that at times when you have a gang of people who walk in, instead of...
This new form of participatory democracy is attracting attention and capturing the imagination of people throughout the region. Grenadians are creating a new form of government which is more responsive to their needs than any they've ever experienced. The new democracy is still being created, but already Grenadians have participated in the preparation of the national budget. And soon, the recently established Constitution Commission will submit a first draft of the new constitution to the zonal councils for debate, changes, and approval.
To congratulate Comrade Book on his splendid explanation. I think he has done a job.
There is no other country in the English-speaking Caribbean where on any night, in any part of their country, you could find a permanent secretary of trade and a budget officer in the Ministry of Finance, together with ministers of government who come forward and report to the people and present themselves for scrutiny. No other country. Solidarity and cooperation among the people of the world. Long live the struggle for peace, social progress, and national liberation. Long live the Grenada Revolution. Long live the fighting people of New Grenada. Forward ever. Thank you very much, and a very pleasant good evening to you, comrades.
I think by now, most of the people have got to the understanding of what all this thing is all about.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
It's so good. I mean, Grenada very going forward.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back. The chat was live. Thank you all for that discussion that's happening and offering resources on different resources to read, more to look into as well. And I'm trying to go through the chat to see some of those book recommendations. So I'll make sure to shout them out later on for folks who might be watching on Twitter or other spaces and not on YouTube. But Afro Phoenix, what were some of your thoughts about this documentary?
Well, it was
about the revolution and
yeah. Well, I totally ignorant about everything. Of course, I was around during that time when Reagan sat down there and they invaded Grenada. Yeah, but we had no idea. That's just, you know, a common person like me here in the United States, we had no idea what they were doing. Just none whatsoever. And I'm just appalled. I'm appalled at, of course, of all that I've learned since I've been affiliated with the APRP. In a nutshell, that's
yeah,
the idea.
Yeah, Carter and Reagan, you know, both played a role in wanting to make sure that Grenada was destabilized and not living in their revolutionary spirit where they have control of their government, control of their land, and the stopping of the exploitation. You know, we learned about how everything that they were produced were being shipped out to European countries and they weren't benefiting it, you know, from their own like natural resources, from the things that they were building. And it was just so informative. That book recommendation was, there was a couple different books recommending, and there was a book about Forward Ever, The Killing of a Revolution, In Nobody's Backyard, The Grenada Revolution in Its Own Words. So those are a couple book recommendations that are being discussed in the chat that goes a little bit more into detail of what the film is sharing with us. So definitely check those out. Thank you so much, Kamal, for making those book recommendations and posting them and sharing. You know, the revolution lasted for 4 years before the assassination and the invasion that happened through US imperialism, right? Where they sent over 7,000 troops from almost every military branch to take over the country. So that's really interesting as well. It was really powerful for me hearing Maurice Bishop, you know, really acknowledge, you know, the country being predominantly African and like what that threat means to the 30 million Africans around the world because of imperialism, right? And knowing that when people are free, look at the joy we were seeing. Look at the children, the women, the men, everyone who's there, right? Even all our people who are non-binary, right? No matter how people identify, but people being able to play a role in their own country, to play a role in their self-determination, for people to learn about what's happening with their labor. So if you're working in agriculture, what you're producing, where the money goes, what does it look like for things to be like revenue driven, but for them to know all aspects of it, like that's pretty empowering and pretty powerful. And that's not what governments want folks to know and be aware of. And like the thing that really, you know, also celebrated my heart is the children talking about how they want people in the US, the child said, talked about in the United States, how they wanted us to be experiencing the revolutionary Grenada, what they were experiencing, a Grenada, they wanted us to be experiencing, and that's really powerful. So everyone playing a role, everyone learning about the revolution and keeping the country ran through collectivism, collective decision-making, even working on their constitution as well. So lots of things were happening in the documentary.
Yes, I was well aware of that as well. The education and the women's organization, the agriculture, and again, to reiterate what you were talking about, is people seeing really from seed to the end of how they were able to consume their own products. That's a lesson in economics that most of us are totally out of tune with.
Yeah, you saw a whole shift in the country. Like the people talked about when Eric Garney was in power, how there was no services, how there was like no infrastructure, no roads, like no medical care happening. And, you know, And he also wanted to liquidate, to murder the people who were in opposition. So the New Jewel movement, right, that was in opposition to have a revolution. And so they went from having no resources, right, to everything being exploited, to working together to have access. So it was just like beautiful to see, you know, even though there was going to be struggle, right, because when there's so much oppression, so much exploitation happening, but being able to move together, like move as a village, move as a collective, for everyone to thrive, right? Like that's what socialism is about. You know, they also govern themselves under like Marxism as well. And so it was just very interesting. Someone's talking about in the chat about just what happened around what education did in 1 year. And to be clear, it's not the education that we see in this country, in the United States. It's like the education that was African driven, that was African controlled, so that they can not just learn about identity, but learn about like the revolution, learn about their needs. And then they also had medical care, quality medical care, right? Housing, access to housing. So many things changed. And so we know what's possible, right? We can see what can happen with the revolution of our people being uplifted together, right? How we're in it together. And that's so important of why this story needs to be told. Those book recommendations, I know I'm gonna check them out because there's an opportunity for me to learn more as well. But we can see the possibilities of our people struggling together for socialism, struggling together for the revolution. And that's what I wanna see, and I definitely wanna be involved in.
This was a really—
turning it over to example. You after this.
I was saying, yeah, that I think this is, this documentary about Grenada was an excellent example, as you reiterated also, about socialism and how people coming together, everybody putting an effort into one goal, and all the children too was just fabulous. Everybody had a role, and that's again what we learn is that the importance of everyone being involved, everyone, absolutely everyone.
Definitely. Someone posted also in the chat that so glad AAPRP had relation with the new Jewel movement. Maurice Bishop spoke at African Liberation Day in DC. It says that we participated in African Liberation Day and their Women's Day in the 1980s. That's beautiful. Thank you so much for uplifting that history that happened.
Again, this was, again, an example of why the United States and the Western power are so concerned about oppressing and repressing, especially African people, because we are a threat. We are a threat to them. The CIA, the military, and all of them.
And the reason why we're a threat is because they exploit us so much, right? They make money off of us in every single way. You know, even in the documentary, it talked about the making money through enslavement, right? Continued enslavement of the people. And that's what that exploitation of labor was. And what was really interesting that I didn't know about Grenada is about the role of women as organizers, and they had the, I think it was the National Women's Organization. What did you think about that, Afro Phoenix, about the role women were playing through the National Women's Organization?
Because of their organizing powers and ability, they were not only uplifting themselves, but all the people. And of course, we know that the women and the non-binary or all other you know, what do they say, not normal people, but how it is so important, so important, and that everyone was involved. I love that. I just love that whole principle about everybody pitching in, and it uplifts everyone.
Definitely. It's, you know, they didn't necessarily use the world like gender rights or gender roles, but they talked about, you know, in society, we're all conditioned in patriarchy, like everything's run under patriarchy. And so making sure that the National Women's Organization had a role that way that rights can be extended to everyone. And that power, that's what they talked about, that power could be extended to everyone in the Grenadian society. And so like power, everyone has a role in power, including women. And so to me, that was very intentional due to like the way patriarchy is in society. And so we also know like with our own revolution, how that's gonna be really critical and important for women to always organize in that space, right? For us to also unlearn and unpack, you know, patriarchy and how that impacts us. And also that's a role like men need to play as well in unpacking that.
Just another side note. I know I was speaking to an individual the other day about, Elizabeth II dying. She was one of the major players in this whole thing. I noticed that. Can you maybe clarify that a bit?
You know, I was briefly reading about it, and it didn't really talk on, it didn't really elaborate, but it was talking about how, like, at first it was colonized by the French, Grenada, mm-hmm. and then how British ruled it, but it didn't really go into detail. And so that's definitely something to research. If anybody else in the chats know about the question Afro Phoenix just posed, definitely post it and we'll read it out loud. So that's something to learn about. You know, that's what we see is all these European countries really playing a role in the continued, in our continued harm. Right. And Britain did that. Britain played that role, which is why, you know, our people, you know, rose up, you know, to have a revolution there in Grenada. Excuse me.
The other thing.
So good
too,
question. Okay. Go ahead, Afro Phoenix.
Oh, the other thing that stood out was about the triangular slave trade and how it is so similar to what happened in the colonies here in the United States and of course all around the world. And they were just it's astounding how they were able to go, what they did, how evil they are. They went in and they wiped out the Arawaks and the Caribs and brought the Africans in as slaves. And it was on such a mass scale. It's hard to believe. But of course, we know because we're the examples and we're the heirs of this horrific thing that has happened to us all around the world. It's just not one place, not two places or three places. It's all over the planet.
Definitely. You know, with you talking about colonialism, Emma just also uplifted, you know, in the chat regarding the National Women's Organization and their role in the Grenada revolution is because of with colonization comes patriarchy. And even ending colonization, it's not going to end patriarchy because it's so embedded in society. And so there has to be a consciousness to struggle to end it, right? And so that's a role that the National Women's Organization played. So thank you for uplifting that. But yeah, colonization is so deep and has impacted our people so much. And that's also, you know, these documentaries, these films really emphasize that. And I also appreciate these films being about what's happening to our people in other countries, because it connects us as Africans to people all over, because oftentimes we're not learning about imperialism, or we're not learning about how colonization is impacting our people in other places. We often learn about how it's impacting Africans here in the belly of the beast and the United Snakes, but learning about how it impacts people in the Caribbean, people in Venezuela, you know, people in Cuba is so critical and important. So that's why I really always appreciate these film series, because it really helps with that.
Indeed.
Afrophoenix, can you ask your question again? It was missed about Queen Elizabeth and the role in.
I think is that she was the one that knighted them or something like that. She heaped praise on them, and that was Elizabeth, the one that just died the other day. And so, I know what I was going to say is that. The person was asking me what I thought about Queen Elizabeth as the world mourns. I said, definitely will not be mourning. This is one person who will not be mourning Elizabeth, because she represents all the evil thing through all these hundreds of years that they have impacted on the planet. And right now, that world is supposedly celebrating her passing. And it's just a horrible, evil empire. And I'm glad to see it go.
Thank you, Afrophoenix, for repeating your question, like wanting to know what role she played, or what role the British government played, or specifically her, you asked, in the destabilization of Grenada. So if anyone knows that, please answer that. There was also another question posed in the chat. When we're thinking about literacy, with the state of literacy within colonized communities, can that be overcome without a revolution? That's such an interesting question. It was like they did the revolution and then they started doing education in what we saw. And I also wonder, you know, I don't know the pre-work, the organizing, the deep organizing work that took place also to overthrow the government, to have a revolution. So I'm wondering too, if they were doing political education and people were learning about the destabilization of the country, because there were people who knew there was no infrastructure, there was no medical care, there was no roads being built. And so I wonder what was happening, because, you know, Eric Gary, like he knew about the revolution that was happening and was really trying to like have them assassinated, you know. So I wonder if they were doing political education. So I wonder if it's a both and, is like we educate our people together. Like every time I learn something new when I'm reading in work study, or if I'm in the films, or if I'm going to another political education space, I'm learning something new. And I wonder about how do we make sure that things are accessible, that, you know, when we're talking around, when we're using words like colonization, that we define them and describe them. So I wonder if it's a both and, are we doing some political education? Because when I think about this country, the American dream has been so sold to us. The individualistic mentality, like white supremacy, penetrates so many things on individualism, not being vulnerable, working yourself ahead, pulling yourself up by your bootstraps. And oftentimes we're not seeing ourselves as one village. We're not seeing ourselves as one people. And so I wonder, how that's also important to see, like, no, our people are not getting ahead in this country. Our people have never been ahead in this country. They never will be, because that's the purpose of colonization, right, is the exploitation of our people, no matter if you look at housing, if you look at poverty, if you look at incarceration, if you look at all those things, we're all impacted. And then like, what do we do to fire our people up to be in an organization so we can have a revolution? So I know sometimes people feel it and see it, and but people might not know about what happened in Haiti, what happened in Cuba, what happened in Mozambique, Nicaragua. What happened in Nicaragua, what happened in Grenada. And so the more we learn what's possible, the more we're like, oh no, we don't have to live in this like oppressive society. We can change it. Cause I think people are just really sold on it. We're so conditioned, and it's everywhere. Like everywhere you drive, there's an American flag like indoctrinating you, you know? And like everywhere you drive, you know, there's just things just really indoctrinating you in this society. And so I think we have to unlearn that shit in order to like get involved and get our people activated. But it takes a lot. It takes a lot. I don't know, what are you all's thoughts here in the chat? Let's see. Afro Phoenix, Ricky Ryan saying that Guarani's range was predicted on independence from Britain. So much of his embrace of decades was based on that, is what's being shared as a response. Oops, to your question. Sorry, here I have to look on my phone here while I'm on the computer because the internet's not working too well here. Is what's being said here in the chat and responding to that.
Thanks, Ricky. Thanks
to that question.
So much information packed in that film. And so, you know, just going through it and taking out the pieces and things like that that stood out is a challenge in itself. So much information. And they did an excellent job of putting that documentary together.
Yeah. It was really powerful. I wish I have to watch it again with my son. But yeah, we're really in doctrine, you know, Comrade Zach talks about how we're really taught to think in a imperialist capitalist framework, and people are trying to survive. So, you know, you get up, you go to work, you do your thing, you go home drained, you go home tired. Like, are you involved in an organization? Are you involved in unlearning? Are you involved in political education? And so it's like, people have to go to work to survive in this capitalist society. And so, well, why is this a society capitalist? And guess what? We can have a different society, you know, if we organize together, because this isn't working for anyone. Capitalism isn't working for anyone. It only supports, you know, the wealthy, right? And so once we see that, once we really, really see and understand that, you know, we can have some change. People are struggling. I think we had some missed opportunities, you know, when, you know, Trump was in office, of like the struggle that was happening. And so we have to really make sure that we're, and that, because people were in survival mode, you know, people were trying to survive, you know, through the turmoil that they were suffering, like economically. And then not just that, the grief of so many people passing during the pandemic as well. And so there's lots happening with capitalism.
Indeed. And I'm fortunate to be here too, that I've lived through two bouts of COVID.
What are your thoughts, Afro Phoenix? Yes, we're so glad that you're here. An elder getting COVID is very scary for us. What are your thoughts about with the state of literacy in colonized communities? Can that be overcome without a revolution? What are your thoughts about that?
Well, I think it can be, because we have many examples. And that's again, what makes it so threatening. We have so many examples of the overthrow of these colonial powers being driven out of the different countries. So yes, it is possible. And the dream is still alive.
Thank you so much for sharing your wisdom. Someone in the chat said, we definitely need to do real literacy work pre-revolution, but I think the literacy revolution would be predicated on a material revolution. Thank you, Comrade Nwandi Obi, for sharing that.
Another idea on that, I wanted to bring it back to the AAPRP community garden, is that with that every time people meet out there, there is political education, and that's so very, very important about reaching out to people and it coming into play, and people having the opportunity every time they come to the garden. And of course,
definitely. So the South chat.
Go ahead,
Afro Phoenix. My internet's unstable. I accidentally talked over you. My internet's unstable.
No problem. But again, as I say, this is something that everybody can not just theorize, but they can actually experience, because they can see the plants growing. The efforts that are being put in there at the garden, and also the generosity of the participants and people helping and bringing to mind about that organic fridge that you posted, was it yesterday or today, about the donation, people giving, because they can see and they can experience, they can eat the produce. I think we need to have more of that. Another thing that I'm thinking about too is that, because I'm experiencing it in my own family, about how our sisters, brothers, all of our people are hooked on these nasty, nasty drugs. And I don't know the name of them, but the popular stuff, because I have a brother who is totally lost to the drugs. I think it may be meth. I don't know. I don't know that much about the recreational drug scene. But so many of our young people, and my brother's not young. He's 65 or something like that, and he's totally lost to it.
And so when I think about that, Afro Phoenix, I'm so sorry to hear that. We have so many in our community struggling with addiction. The government pumped drugs into our community to kill our people. I remember being 8 years old and growing up in the crack pandemic and watching it flood our community, and seeing some people still like using, struggling with addiction, and others not. And so that's really huge. And I know there's a lot of farmers that talk about how the garden can be medicine, how the farm can be medicine, like planting, our hands in the earth, like finding healing that, right? Healing from that trauma. There's so much generational trauma that our people face, right? And lack of access and resources to health. And one thing I think about the garden when you're talking about it, and the garden is intentionally and strategically a community defense project. And in the garden, we always do a political education topic. Majority of the topics, we do connect mostly internationally and then bring it back locally. So if we're talking about environmental justice, we're talking about what that looks like in other countries. That way people are able to learn that the what's happening here, right, is, with indigenous communities, for example, of where the uranium's happening, where the water's being polluted, of where the fracking is happening, of where the sexual exploitation's happening, the murder of indigenous women, like those things are happening in Africa, you know, and how they're connected, how it's connected through imperialism and colonialism. That's so critical. And it is such a joy when our high school students, like the Black student unions, the African student unions come, they get deep in the political education discussion. They hunger for these things. And so it's up to us to talk to our people about this. They're not gonna learn these things in school, but they are able to reflect and have these really deep conversations, right? About how they see what's happening in their own communities. And then the other thing I think about growing food, you know, because we might not have access to food in 6-7 years because of, you know, climate change and everything that this government is doing to the land, right? Of the land of indigenous people, the land that we're on, the stolen land, is, you know, being when you plant, you don't know what's going to grow. And the hope and faith you have, and it reminds me of the revolution, the hope and faith we have, we may not know what's going to happen. You know, our ancestors, you know, couldn't have, I don't know if they could have imagined where we are now, right? I can't even imagine what it's going to be like 2 years from now. But the hope you have when a seed is planted and things grow. And so there's cucumbers, there's tomatoes, and all the majority of all the plants we have, like you said, Afrofinance was gifted. It was gifted, it's being shared. We don't have water in the ground because this trash, this city, right, does not want to put water on the land, but that's okay because we use olas, which are made by the Moors, our people, the Africans that we use to water. And we're so thankful for the comrades where we water twice a day. So people haul water to water food that grows there that we share with community. And so there's so much richness. So we're in community together. We're talking about political education. We're talking about organizing, talking about revolution. We're growing food together. We're eating food together. So there's just so much hope, right? And so I just think about like the joy I experience that we get to experience in the garden. We're there every first, second, and third Sunday. Like the joy of those conversations and imagine the joy of actually being and living in a revolution, right? That's where I want to be. That's where we want all of our people to be.
You know, everyone on the call, I haven't been to the garden, but I've seen in photos and, of course, being in work study and community education. So I benefit from that as well, as I say, although I haven't been out there because AAPRP members were protecting me and keeping me isolated so that I didn't have to go out there. But I'm very, very grateful. Yeah, but AAPRP, they're doing great work, and just everything that's being done, reaching out to everyone all around the world. I'm just always impressed with like things that come on the discussion in Slack and things like that. It's just wonderful. I'm just, again, duly impressed and happy to be a part of it. And whatever little contributions I can make, I'm grateful to do that.
Yeah, I reflect on together we know a lot and together we get to learn a lot. And, you know, this space that's happening on the YouTube channel, there's so much discussion happening where it's a shared learning space. And a shared learning space creates that political education for us to dream and imagine together, you know, what a socialist society can look like. And we also have examples of what a socialist society can look like. So we have something to start with. So we also don't have to start from scratch. but we can build this together and reimagine it together. There are, you know, there's comments being elevated again about how much it's important to learn about the revolutionary work that's happening in Cuba, in Nicaragua, and Venezuela. And so we definitely have our work to do to learn about those different things. And we oftentimes see those countries under attack. No, we see those countries under attack by US imperialism all the time because they are striving for a socialist society where everyone's needs are met in housing and medical care and food and shelter, where everyone is cared for. And so that's why these countries, you know, even Grenada, were, you know, being under attacked, their revolutions, what's the word, being put on a magnifying glass and trying to be dismissed, right? And also being attacked, their work being attacked as well. And they do that because it's strategic for them to create barriers and to create continuous challenges for us to learn about the possibilities. Because what we have here is not working. It is not working in no way, shape, or form for any of us. And so, so much hope for the revolution and what can happen. I also appreciate it. It was toward the end. She said she's a militant woman and how she will work to defend her country. And so that's how we have to think about the revolution, how we will organize to defend our people. We will organize to set our people free. We will organize to liberate our people. And when we get that mindset, and when we really understand that, there's no stopping us. Our people are struggling and hurting no matter where they are. And it's been overtime. It's been overtime for us to have a revolution. It has to happen. And so I'm really excited personally to go read the book recommendations that were shared, because I know too little about this revolution, and I'm here to learn more and to grow and to, you know, play my role in the revolution for our people.
One other book, I think it was, that I noticed in the chat was What Really Happened in Grenada? ? So I, of course, this is all new to me as well. I'm anxious, and perhaps maybe this might be a subject that we can discuss in work study or geopolitical.
Oh, that would be a good geopolitical book to suggest. That's a really great idea.
Well, we certainly appreciate everyone's contribution out there in the internet world. At least I do.
Yes, we're in our virtual community together. So thank you all for joining us. Thank you all for your contributions and sharing your thoughts, ideas, book recommendations, answers to questions people are posing in the chat. And we hope you come back and join us. We're here every second Saturday of the month at 2 p.m. Mountain Standard Time. We'll be showing another film. And, you know, it was put in the chat, forward ever, backwards never. So stay ready for the revolution. Thank you all for joining us.